So how do Republicans in the House feel about all this? We may find out in a vote in the next few hours. And Congressman Ted Yoho of Florida joins me now. Congressman, thanks so much. Let's get right to the point. Will you vote for the House bill as it stands now, as it's been changed?
Jake, I'd have to see it. I haven't seen the completed language on that, and so without reading that, I can't support that. But taking out the things that we originally wanted in there, no, I can't support that, that bill at this time.
Okay, just to go through the outline of what Dan has said, and I understand it's not the precise language in front of you, but it's the government spending, government would be reopened until December 15th. The debt limit would be raised until February. No extraordinary measures will be allowed to be taken by the Treasury Secretary. And then what's being called the full vitter, the amendment saying that members of Congress, members of the cabinet, president, vice president, and all their staffs would have to enter the Obamacare exchanges, and the money that's already being spent on their health care would not be allowed to be subsidized to them, the full vetter, staffers, and obviously the politicians. That's not enough for you to support this bill.
No, it's not. I co-sponsored the Vitter DeSantis amendment, and I think that's a fair thing to do make sure we pay the same thing everybody else in America does. It's unconstitutional that Congress can pass a law that doesn't apply to them also. I mean, it's a common sense thing, and it's a shame that we have to have another bill to say what the Constitution already says. But the other things that were in what I saw this morning, I can't support.
Well, just to drive down a little deeper on the thing about staffers, I think the idea is Senator Grassley here in the Senate pushed forward the idea that everybody who is responsible for this bill would have to also enter the Obamacare exchanges. But there was concern, since a lot of people on Capitol Hill don't make that much money, they make $20,000, $30,000, $40,000 a year, that the money already being spent on their health care, would there be a way to use that money so that they can buy the health care? And if you don't do that, essentially, you're taking all these staffers who don't make a lot of money, certainly don't make what you're being paid as a congressman, sir, and giving them a huge pay cut. What's your response to that?
Well, that's going to happen to the American people, too, because they're going to have to abide by the rules of this. And there's a lot of people out there hurting. But think about where we're at, why we're here today. We're here because Congresses of the past, for the last 25, 30 years, have failed to address this problem. This is a time where we're at, and if we don't deal with this problem now, what good is it going to be to extend it till December 15th or January 15th or even February 15th? We're going to go through this again. We're here. I say, let's fix the things that we have to fix now. We've got to address spending. That bill that I've seen does not address any of the spending issues that we've seen. Until we address spending and growing revenues, it's just a non-starter. It's not addressing the underlying cause. It's just kicking the can, and the American people are tired of kicking the can. I was sent up here to stop the can from rolling, to step on it, to keep it from rolling, so that we can address these problems. We're at $17 trillion in debt, and if we don't get this under control now, we're going to $23
trillion. So let's look forward to in 2 days, according to the Secretary of the Treasury, we hit the debt ceiling, and the United States will no longer have all the money it needs to pay all of its bills. Now, you got a lot of attention for a comment you gave to the Washington Post a few days ago. I want to read it and have you explain exactly what you meant. You said, quote, "I think we need to have that moment where we realize we're going broke." And then the Washington Post writer wrote, "If the debt ceiling isn't raised, that will sure as heck be a moment." And then back to you saying, "I think personally it would bring stability to the world markets." Are you suggesting, and correct me, I'm just trying to interpret this quote, are you suggesting that hitting the debt limit would bring stability to world markets?
No, not raising the debt ceiling is not an automatic trigger for default. That's one thing. Raising the debt ceiling and default are two different issues. We've got enough money coming in to service our debt, the principal and interest. We've got more than enough to service that. What I'm saying is this is a time to address this, and if we take this head on, my feeling is our creditors will be thankful that we're finally saying, you know what, instead of kicking the can down the road, instead of having this debate, instead of raising our debt limit to $23 trillion is what it's predicted in the next 4 years, let's deal with this now, let's get it under control, and that would bring stability so that we don't go through this every year or every year and a half. Let's put an end to it. Let's get to regular order, regular appropriations, let's get back to a budget. Those are the things that the American people want. And I say this is the time, because not to do it now, you're going to have to do it at the first of the year or 6 months from now or a year. The American people are tired of that. It's time that we address this problem head on. And if I truly believe that if we do that, our creditors will breathe a sigh of relief and say, thank goodness, they're finally getting this under control. They finally get it.
Sir, are you paying attention at all to what's been going on with Treasury bills? I think there is concern out there. The Treasury bills are selling. It's a tepid market right now.
Sure.
And there is concern that not every, you know, every Thursday about $100 billion rolls over. And there is concern that maybe it's not going to roll over. Maybe some of those creditors are going to say, you know what, this is not a good investment anymore. This is not a stable economy anymore. Not to mention what might happen on the stock market. I'm sure you're familiar with what happened the last time we came this close. You are from Florida. There are a lot of retirees. I can't imagine that they're happy about the idea that their nest eggs might shrink because we keep getting closer and closer to hitting the debt ceiling.
Well, we do, but there again, hitting the debt ceiling is not the issue because, again, hitting the debt ceiling or not raising it is not going to trigger an automatic default. We've got money coming in.
Not a default on our creditors, sir, but there will be a lot of bills that will not be allowed to be paid, and it will send a horrendous message, I think every reputable economist says, to stock markets and to the fact that people's retirement savings is under risk. Retirees lost about $800 billion last time we came this close.
All right, but again, if we don't address it now, Jake, are we going to have to address it again? Are we going to go through it again when we're at more debt? What we've got to look at is stabilizing this market so that we can get it under control so it brings certainty to that market. You know, we hit the debt ceiling in 1985. We didn't raise the debt ceiling. We hit it, and we didn't raise it for 3.5 months. We're still here. We hit it again in 1995. For 4.5 months, they didn't raise the debt ceiling. We survived that. We will survive this. A lot of this is media hype. Of course, you had the market drop about 160 points today. Markets are super fluid. And I predict that if we get this under control, we're heading in the right direction, they'll rebound and they'll recapture the lost wealth they had, and they'll recapture that if we get this under control. If we don't get this under control, that's where I would be real concerned about that, because who in heck's going to lend us money if we can't get our own financial house in order? And again, this is the time to address this. This is what I came up here for. And we got sent up here to address these things. And these are tough decisions. Nobody wants anybody laid off. Nobody wants anybody furloughed. Nobody wants the markets to be rattled. But those things are going to happen regardless if we don't get this under control.
Sir, I think I have to disagree with some of the comments you're making. You say nobody wants to be furloughed. The House Republicans, led by individuals such as yourself, decided to attach to the government spending bill a provision defunding Obamacare that was guaranteed to fail in the Senate and be vetoed by the president. That is basically an action to shut down the government.
Jake,
and then
I
appreciate
you
about the unstable markets. It is the fact that there is this instability about whether or not House Republicans are going to go along with a Senate bill that negotiated by Senate Democrats and Republicans that will raise the debt ceiling. And you're right that it wouldn't automatically mean default when it comes to money that the United States owes creditors, but it would mean default to a whole bunch of individuals who are owed money, whether it's veterans or troops or other individuals who depend on the government. So,
okay.
You can respond, sir. I'm sorry.
All right. Well, number one, seniors are going to get paid. Veterans are going to get paid. That's already in. We've already done legislation for that. But going back to what you were saying about
legislation that didn't pass the Senate, by the way.
Yeah. Look at what we started with. We started with defunding Obamacare, the Affordable Care Act, and we put that in the CR. I'm a member of the House. It's a House of the people. We're the voice of the people. I ran on defunding, burying, and getting rid of Obamacare. We ran on it. We got elected. So for me not to represent that in this CR would have been irresponsible for me. And since the House is controlled by the Republicans, a lot of the members of our House, of our conference, ran on the same thing. So for us not to speak up is not speaking up for the American
people. No one's asking you not to speak up, sir. But if you want to get rid of Obamacare, the way you do that is you recapture the Senate and you capture the White House. And I think there are a lot of Republicans out there who think that House Republicans, led by individuals such as yourself, are actually making that job more difficult in the future because you are painting Republicans in a way that polls indicate the American people find incredibly unfavorable, even more unfavorable than they find President Obama and congressional Democrats.
Well, the only poll I'm going to look at is the one comes in November, because that's the one that's going to reflect what the people truly want. And again, I ran on that. We got elected on that. And I'm standing up for that. And the feedback that we're getting is to stay strong for us to capitulate, I think, would be wrong. But look what we did. We sent it over there. They wouldn't even look at it. We sent it back to renegotiate it with just a one-year delay in the Affordable Care Act. The Senate wouldn't even look at it. We sent it back again with an individual delay for just a year. The same thing that the president gave to over 1,600 special interest groups, to unions, to big businesses, and they wouldn't even look at that. And the last thing we sent over there was the individual mandate delay for a year and to go to conference, and they won't go to conference. You know, Bill Clinton went to conference with Newt Gingrich. Ronald Reagan went to conference with Tip O'Neill. They worked through these things. But when you have one side that says, we're not even going to listen to you guys because, you know, they don't want to play.
But Congressman, we have to end this. We've already gone way long. But you know as well as I do that the Senate, after years of not passing a budget, they did pass a budget in March, and the House Republicans have refused to send over conferees. But you know what? Thank you very much for coming in. I appreciate your sharing your views and your thoughts. Congressman Ted Yoho of Florida.
Thank you, Jake.